It is an honor and a privilege to be addressing you here today. Samoa and other Pacific Islands may be a long way from Syria, Yemen, South Sudan, and many of the places around the world experiencing armed conflicts. They are certainly a long way from Switzerland, home of the Geneva Conventions, where many discussions about IHL, the international humanitarian law, the law of war, take place. Despite these long distances, the aim of this roundtable is to reaffirm the relevance of the IHL in the Pacific region. Beyond this, the aim is to create a platform for Pacific Island countries, a powerful regional voice to contribute and influence global efforts to develop and strengthen the rule regulating warfare. Your presence here today indicates a highly encouraging and positive interest in making this a reality. Building on the success of the inaugural Pacific Island Roundtable on IHL held in Nadi, Fiji, 2 years ago, I welcome all the countries around the table back to this forum, and I welcome Tuvalu to participate for the first time. So why this special focus on IHL? It is even relevant in today's armed conflicts. From an humanitarian perspective, the answer is an emphatic yes. In many of the armed conflicts where the ICRC is present, an overriding challenge continues to be the lack of respect by states and non-state armed groups for even the most fundamental rules of IHL. We see widespread violation of IHL, and these often go unpunished. We see direct attacks against civilian and key infrastructure, including hospitals and schools, and we see the delivery of humanitarian access being blocked. This is obviously against fundamental rules that all states, including all those in the Pacific, have agreed to in the Geneva Conventions. Indeed, based on our observations on battlefields across the world, we can say that the problem is not the law or a lack of law, but rather the lack of compliance with the law. As you would know, the kind of violation that I have mentioned are already prohibited by IHL. So, increasing respect for IHL and for the principle of humanity is perhaps the single and most effective way to reduce suffering in war. This is why the ICRC so actively promotes compliance with IHL and why we convene gatherings like this one. At every opportunity, whether to be in our public communications or in discussion we have with heads of state, we highlight the importance of respecting the key principles that govern how violence is conducted in armed conflicts. I am sure you have heard of some of these principles: distinction, proportionality, precaution in attack, the prohibition against unnecessary suffering. We also stress the importance of human treatment for people deprived of their liberty. We advocate for a halt to the use of illegal weapons and the illegal use of weapons, and in general, we call for the protection of people who are not taking part in the conflict. You might ask, how does this all relate to the Pacific region? We are all aware that the region is not immune to armed conflict. Even though there are currently no armed conflicts in the Pacific region, the Bougainville conflict constitutes a non-international armed conflict. The Bougainville Revolutionary Army and PNG forces allied to Bougainville Resistance Forces signed a ceasefire in 1997 and a peace agreement in 2001. The humanitarian consequences of the conflict are still felt today by the families of nearly 1,000 persons who went missing. Most of them are presumed dead. The conflict in Solomon Islands from 1998 till 2003, when the Australian government led a multilateral regional assistance mission to Solomon Islands, is another example to show that not that long ago, there were a conflict in the Pacific. According to some sources, around 200 people died in the conflict, largely on the main island of Guadalcanal, and there were hundreds of cases of adoption and torture. The great majority of victims were innocent civilians. The islands in Papua New Guinea also experienced frequent and deadly tribal fights with enormous humanitarian consequences. Various islands were also affected during World War II. For example, 1,200 Nauruans were forcibly deported to the Caroline Islands to work as slave laborers. Many never returned home. 9 Pacific Island states are still contaminated by ordnance, which has an explosive risk and an environment effect limiting farming, industry, and tourism. Some of Euro-Pacific countries contribute troops to the UN peacekeeping mission in places of armed conflict. Indeed, Samoa has contributed UN peacekeepers for 19 years, and last month it farewelled its latest deployment, bound for South Sudan. We will, of course, be discussing some of the legal frameworks that apply to this kind of deployment in session 3 this afternoon. More broadly, I think it's fair to say that the causes and consequences of armed conflicts and other situations of violence around the world are becoming increasingly complex and far-reaching. These conflicts are often protracted and have regional or even wider repercussions. Syria, Iraq, Libya, South Sudan, Central African Republic, and Afghanistan, to name but a few, and the humanitarian consequences are immense. Massive displacement across continents is one of the most visible consequences. Worldwide displacement is now at the highest level since World War II, with a staggering 68.5 million people having fled their homes. Natural disaster or environmental problems, which the Pacific region understands better than most, can of course also have catastrophic and far-reaching results. And these impacts are greatly exacerbated by socioeconomic problems or conflict. Many Pacific countries are at the forefront on the effects of climate change and rising sea levels. And I will be very interested to hear from you all in session 2 later today. When we will explore what happens when the effects of climate change and armed conflict converge. This builds on the discussion we had in NADI in 2017, when the Pacific states acknowledged that climate change and conflict can cause a double vulnerability for civilian populations. Speaking of global threats, we cannot ignore what might be the biggest threat of all in terms of the potential magnitude and scope of humanitarian consequences, the use of nuclear weapons. These regions know the effect of nuclear testing all too well. If such weapons were used today, the effects would be so catastrophic that the whole of humanity would be at risk. The Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons, adopted in 2017 and initially signed by 7 states in this region, and now ratified by 5, clearly recognized this risk. It offered real hope for a future free of nuclear weapons by comprehensively prohibiting nuclear weapons on the basis of those fundamental principles of IHL that I mentioned earlier. Ending the era of nuclear weapons is something that the ICRC and our partners in the Red Cross and Red Crescent movement, including several national Red Cross societies participating in this roundtable, have worked hard towards for more than 70 years. We have been and will continue to actively promote this treaty, and we urge states to ratify and implement it as quickly as possible to ensure it enters into force. So, in short, everyone here has a stake, an interest, in promoting respect for IHL globally. None of us are fully immune to the consequences of a failure to do so, even in the absence of active armed conflict in the region. Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, the Geneva Convention, the key international treaties that underpin IHL, achieved universal acceptance with Nauru's accession in 2006 as the 194th state party. This year marks 70 years of the conventions, which makes our IHL roundtable very timely. You will be talking more about these conventions tomorrow morning, and I look forward to hearing your ideas as to how we can continue to strengthen and uphold their protection. There have, of course, already been many highly commendable initiatives at national level by Pacific states to strengthen, develop, implement, and promote IHL. At the last roundtable in 2017, the participants committed to considering measures to give effect to IHL, including the creation of National Committee on IHL, which provide a permanent platform for IHL discussion in country. The Vanuatu delegation went back home and did exactly that, and today you have three key members of the newly formed Vanuatu IHL committee sitting here with us. The 2070 roundtable encouraged Pacific Island countries to work towards ratification of the Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons. 1 year later, in 2018, Cook Islands, New Zealand, Palau, Samoa, and Vanuatu all became party to that treaty. We will be talking more about this and other impressive developments in the final session tomorrow at the session 6. We will also be talking tomorrow about how to bring all these efforts and initiatives together to combine forces and create a powerful regional voice with global influence. The 33rd International Conference of the Red Cross and Red Crescent Movement will be held in December this year in Geneva. This conference only occurs every 4 years, and it brings together the world's largest humanitarian network in the form of the ICRC, National Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Society, and almost all states in the world. This is a key opportunity for states and grouping like the Pacific to have their voice heard on key humanitarian issues. I am sure many of you will either be attending this conference or will be involved in drafting briefing for your delegates. So I urge you to use this roundtable to start to think about the issues that your state may be able to contribute to in the lead up to and at the 33rd International Conference. There is a vast and diverse expertise and experience in this room. Now is the time to harness these valuable resources, to exchange knowledge, ideas, and lessons learned about IHL implementation, and to discuss how to better raise awareness on IHL among influential actors such as parliamentarians, academia, and civil society. Today is the first day of this dedicated forum for discussions on the law of war and their importance in the Pacific region. ahead of the 33rd International Conference and the next roundtable in 2 years' time, I very much hope that this new regional voice will gather strength and ultimately make itself heard on a global stage. In the end, better respect for the laws of war matters to all of us here, no matter where in the world we live. Fafetai Telelava.